Hello, everybody. It's another fantastic episode of the North Pacific's NBS. So I'm Ghost, the Minister of Communications, and I'm going to attempt to very badly do the hosting thing that Fiji did so well in the past. And we're going to talk about the recent election and get some perspective from outside voices and how they do elections on their end. So, helping me do that is my little team here of a few really experienced people in the communications department, as well as some new faces. So, I'll let them introduce themselves. So, go ahead, guys.
Hello, I'm Bob Arino, current Deputy Minister of Communications, Deputy Minister of Home Affairs, and Minister of Defense. I've been serving the Ministry of Communications as Deputy Minister since October in the middle of Fiji's first term. And yeah, that's my role.
Hi, I'm Bootsy, current court justice. I'm also a security counselor, global moderator, and host of award-winning Bootsy Radio.
I'm Darkania, the current Attorney General, ex Minister of Defense before Bob Arino, been in NBS since the beginning.
All right. Well, I'm Wally or Wallenberg, and I am the World Assembly Minister for the East Pacific.
I guess it's my turn now. I'm Mouth, not Mouthy. NPA General, a deputy something, and that's about it.
Deputy something. Okay. Yeah, so that's our little team here. As is traditional, the NBS first show of the term tends to talk about what just happened in the region. The big news was the election. So that's partly the reason why Fiji isn't doing this, because he won the election for delegates. So I guess table panel, what do you think of the results of the election or the stories of the election or whatever?
Shall I go first then? As
Anybody can
the
go, just try not to talk over each other.
loser. Okay, sure. I'll go first then. Well, I think the results of the election were very good people, like very safe options. I think overall, everyone who's elected can do a very good job and will and actually has done a very good job because they were large incumbents. So, yeah, I think it was a good election. Anybody else?
I would have preferred a bit more competition in the election, but we still elected good people, except for me.
Yeah, I do think that, well, it was kind of weird, to be honest. I think, well, Bank's delegate was very competitive, obviously. I know that firsthand, but I was disappointed by delegate race. Not because of a lack of good candidates. I mean, Fuji speaks for himself,
Yeah,
but the
Fiji's
competition wasn't enough. Not really. It wasn't ideal.
Honestly,
really.
I would have loved to see a full-on Majak versus Fiji race. And well, what happened was kind of controversial.
No shit. Yeah.
Just a little
But
bit.
yeah, we'll get into that a little bit later. But honestly, a Majak versus Fiji race would have been really, really tight and really, really competitive, similar to the September elections between Ghost, or no, it was the January elections between Ghost and Majak. I would have loved to see that go down again. And that really would have gone down to the wire.
Yeah, I was. What happened with Magic? It's very unfortunate. I mean, I'm not going to say it's not his fault or anything, but I was looking forward to it. Like, I was looking forward to Magic delegacy run, like a serious one, where you would have, not necessarily that he'd win, but that he would present very serious competition like he did with Ghost. And no, it just didn't happen. Not in the end.
Well, actually, Malf, you were a candidate in that election for vice delegate. So I guess we'll just kind of touch on the offices real quick before we talk about the juicy stuff. So, vice delegate, we had Cyril Dorset running again, and he won. He held onto his seat. So, what are the thoughts on that? Because I know we have a lot of opinions from non-TMPers on that race, because Malf is a pretty popular guy overseas.
I'll be honest, I don't know much about Mouth, but from what I know, I'm fairly confident that they'll do a fine job.
Yes, I was actually super excited to see Malf run for the vice delegacy. Obviously, it was a little weird with a sitting security counselor to endorse Mouth for the vice delegacy, but I really, when he came to me about his run for the vice delegacy, I thought that was something that, you know, we could get behind, just because I feel like his work in the MPA as, you know, Minister of Defense and as an MPA general, I thought that would be good, you know, that would translate very, very well to the security counselor portion of the vice delegate's role in the North Pacific.
Well, the new guys have to learn somewhere, and the only way they do that is if they actually, you know, step up and start doing the job. So I guess there's a lot to be said for that.
Yeah, I mean, I think there is kind of an issue where you're not really acclimated to a role, or don't think you know enough about it. You're not going to run for it, are you? Because you don't think you can do the job? I think you have to make that leap. You have to kind of go into uncharted territory if you want to progress, because otherwise you're just going to stay where you are in it forever. That's what I was trying to do, basically. I was trying to go somewhere I hadn't gone before and try to move my career forward. I'll be honest with you. The first person I asked before you, Bootsy, was actually Sill himself, a good 2 months or something before the election. And my question was, are you going to run? He said that he didn't know yet. He said he wasn't sure. It's too early to know. So I was kind of banking on him not running, because at the end of the day, the incumbent is almost invariably going to win. Has anybody here know a time when the incumbent actually lost against the new
for
runner?
The vice delegate race specifically, I remember Keish was running for vice delegate, and he was the incumbent, but Sawale actually beat him for the vice delegacy.
That's true, actually.
And yeah, that was a really big upset.
Yeah, and then Sawale won by a single vote against MCM when he ran for election.
Yeah, I do remember that, vaguely. But ultimately, I'm a fan of how I did. I got a good amount of votes, a lot of experience, so... And if Sill wasn't good at his job, he wouldn't have got elected now, would he? So, I'm happy with that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's not really a matter of the incumbent is extremely likely to win, because the incumbent is often voted down, is actually voted down pretty often in TNP. It's just that they do have a lot they can point back to as, hey, this is proof that I can do what I do.
Yeah, that's very true. I mean, I know when I'm voting, it's always a matter of what is, you know, best for the region. And at the end of the day, having somebody who's already in the spot, already acclimated to it, already has shown they can do it properly, is the safer option by a long shot, whichever way you spin it.
I think one of the things Sill had in his favor was that he made very concrete and very attainable campaign promises. Like, I don't know if he actually did put a number on his turnaround time in terms of the vice delegacy check, but he said that he would streamline. He said that he'd put out the weekly reports. He said that he'd put out some numbers with the weekly reports. And he said that he would take a more numbers-based approach. And all of those things he fulfilled with flying colors. So if you wanted to run a political campaign against Sill, there would be very little to point to, which really works in his favor.
Yeah. And yeah, the thing about Sill is that he's pretty much done everything he promised ever and done it well. And I didn't want to have to. I didn't want to try to run an aggressive campaign, I guess. I mean, I said I was banking on him not running, to be honest. I was hoping that I would be uncontested mostly. But you can't really run an aggressive campaign, A, because I didn't want to, but B, when it's Sill. He's so good at his job, it's uncomfortable.
He had some very tough decisions to make in that term, too.
Oh, he so did. He really did. I mean, with Cormac, and he dodged Draven by a bit, thankfully. That would have been even worse if he had actually gone through. But yeah, he made a lot of hard decisions and he pulled off. Go respect that.
Okay, so in addition to those offices, the, you know, the big two, we also had the Speaker and the Attorney General. So any thoughts on those two races? I know that Attorney General ended up being slightly more interesting than usual this time around for a variety of reasons. But before we get into that, any thoughts on the Speaker? I thought that was probably the most predictable result, and probably the least interesting, least controversial, but, you know, still, Speaker's a very important job, and I'm very glad that we had a competent incumbent to run and who would hold on to the seat. Any thoughts on that?
Artemis is such a great speaker. I love having Artemis as the speaker, and I hope he continues, you know, to enjoy doing the speaker role for as long as he has that role.
Honestly, Artemis, I'm with Bootsy. Hands down, incredible speaker.
Agreed.
Like, I was his deputy for the first 3 months of last term before Dark left the Minister of Defense position, to which Ghost appointed me, and I've been since. And Artemis did a really good job, not only of doing speaker checks really quickly and really efficiently, but also training up his deputies. Like, I had a vague idea of how to run checks and a vague idea of how to put together the RA digest to the standard that ABC had published it under his speakership. But I never really had a concrete idea of what went down, what needed to go down, what happened. Artemis filled in those gaps and then some. He did a really good job of training me to be a proper deputy speaker, and for that, I'm grateful. If I wanted to run for speaker, I could run for speaker, and I would be qualified.
Personally, I'm not that involved in that side of TNP, the legal, the speaker, the justices, the attorney general. But from what I've seen and from what I've been told, yeah, he seems fantastic. Does his job well.
The speaker race may have been kind of boring just from a numbers perspective, because yeah, Artemis was going to win. Everyone just kind of expected that, and it happened. But the thing that was really interesting about it for me was actually Dredson's campaign, which was actually, like, he knew he was new to the office, but he was dedicated to learning the job if he would get elected. He was dedicated to kind of advancing himself in TNP and getting his name out there. And he actually ended up becoming the next deputy speaker. And he actually really impressed me with his campaign, even though he's rather new to the idea of all the laws to the region. And Duropia, actually, way back when, actually did the same to me when he ran for AG when he first showed up. And Duropia ended up being a pretty big name for a while before he just up and disappeared. So I'm expecting Dredson to be a big name within the next year.
That's a question I got too. Honestly, well, I was actually very impressed with Dredson too. I know he's in the VC right now, but he struck me as very professional and very good at it. Well, not very good at his job, didn't get it, but it's very unexpected. I didn't expect him to be as knowledgeable as he was. I didn't expect him to be as enthusiastic as he was. So I could definitely see him advancing much further in the future.
Now, that is something I like about TMP, is you don't always have to win the election to get a boost from it, to still raise your profile, get a shot, because sometimes the people who come close but don't make it, they reveal themselves as the next up-and-comers, and usually they go for it again, they'll probably succeed, or at the very least, you know, now Dredton in another run will be even more prepared, because we're now as deputy speaker, making a run as deputy speaker, you know, traditionally that tended to be how the next speaker was chosen, although that, you know, those cycles in the past year or so kind of shook up that pattern. But I definitely agree. I was impressed, and actually I was thinking very similar to the Duropia campaign. Where'd you come from? You're really cool, and can't wait to see what you do next. So that was kind of my takeaway from that aspect of the race. Anyone else have any thoughts on that before we shift over to the AG race?
Another thing I'd like to weigh in on with Dredton is, and also a few others, like, I'll shout out Robespierre. Both of them have kind of popped up out of nowhere in TNP right around the election, and I like that. I come from a my story is that I showed up in March, and I immediately joined the NPA starting April 1st of 2018, and a year later I'm Minister of Defense. It's like, and this kind of new blood is what I kind of like to see in the region, because it really injects life into the region and can get things moving in a really good direction. And so these kind, Dredton and Robespierre, I really like where they're going, and I want to watch their career arcs.
Right, yeah, especially with all of us old people. To NS, it is very nice and very reviving to see TMP not only embracing its tradition, but also looking towards the next, you know, 10, 15, however many years TMP ends up going for, but to see how that evolves.
I'm not old, I'm a year old.
Yeah, actually, I know I'm going to diverge a little bit from our planned topic, but I'm curious, since we have Wally here, how does this whole thing we're talking about, TMP with our elections and, you know, how we're bringing the new talent up and whatever, how does that work where you come from?
You know, as a World Assembly minister or just as, you know, member of TEP or what?
Well, kind of like any position for them, you know, when people are coming up, elections to the extent that you guys have elections and how those work there. Kind of like, how does it compare? How does that experience in TEP compare to TMP when it comes to elections and, you know, people coming up and, you know, the talent moving up the chain, I guess?
I think that, especially for our last election, the delegacy is a whole lot more contested. It seems to me, at least, that the lower offices are, you know, less interesting to most people. And, you know, a whole lot of that stuff just gets either filled from the bottom up or is appointed by the delegate themselves. So, you know, the delegate definitely seems to have a maybe a bit stronger of a say on exactly what regional policy is going to be. I don't know.
Well, how many elections do you guys have, and how does it work there?
It's an annual election by my recollection, and so, you know, we have a fairly frequent rotation, especially if, you know, someone's resigning or if there's a sudden need for a change of leadership. But, you know, at least with Fidele, we've had him for 2 years now. He's doing pretty well, so, you know. It's sort of, there is a good incumbency bit that, you know, can make elections less competitive, but it really does depend on how well the delegate works and exactly, you know, how much of their policy they can get through in that year.
Well, I don't want this to turn into an interview, but I guess anyone else have any questions for Wally about how that works before we switch back to AG? Guess not. Okay, well.
Oh, so bad now.
It's well, it's okay. I wanted to kind of compare them because, you know, TEP is also a democratic region to a reasonable degree, I believe. But I feel like we don't really get a lot of excitement from other GCR democracies, and I just kind of was always curious how they compared. But AG race, which I think would be an example from what Wally was saying of one of the lower races that people don't pay as much attention to. Interesting in this cycle because AG was part of the campaign was about how some people wanted the position to cease to exist. So we had people running for office here for an office that may not even exist by the end of the following term, depending on how legislation would go. So I thought it was kind of cool to see how the existence of the office itself was a key part of the campaign. We had 3 people run for the office, and we ended up with a runoff. So we actually had to do 2 different elections for this position. And it was a little more interesting than what we've typically seen from AG in the past, but I'll let you guys kind of feed on that one a little bit.
Most competitive AG election ever.
Yeah, that's the impression I got too.
This is technically the lowest margin that I've won an AG race by, because the first one was technically 100% because no one else was running.
Yeah. It's kind of a weird place where you got delegacy practically uncontested and you got the AGB competitive as hell. It's not what you'd expect.
I'm kind of hesitant to comment too much on it because I was in the race and I won the race.
Yeah, so
but
it's kind of.
I think the main thing that caused it to be pretty competitive was that for the people that have been around a while, which generally constitute most of the vote, because they're in the habit of voting and all that jazz, they tended to have their vote divided between myself and Funkadelia. And then I think Dinoium managed to draw most of the votes of the people who were who weren't just around as long or were focused more on the promises he laid out in his campaign. And then that ended up splitting the vote enough that no one got a majority, so we had to do another vote.
I was very interested to see, because for a while there, even with the vote splitting, you still would have gained a majority, but as the votes kept coming in and coming in and coming in, it became a little bit more clear that, yes, a runoff was going to occur. But it would have been interesting to see if you could have, you know, with three competitors, if a majority could have been ever achieved.
Do you guys think that the plans to possibly end the office are a good idea? How do you feel about that bill that's currently being debated about just completely eliminating the position entirely?
So, I'll talk first, because, whatever. So I'm a little torn. Part of me is like, yeah, that seems like a pretty good idea, but other of me is thinking, like, tradition? I don't know. I'm still not sure yet what I'll vote on that bill.
Personally, I haven't paid that much attention to that, to be entirely frank. Like I said, I'm not that involved in the legal AJ judicial side, so I can't really comment.
Okay. Well, since we now have the current Attorney General here with us, I would love to hear his thoughts on this.
I've commented my thoughts already, mainly in the bill. I'm in favor of removing the position. I mean, it'll make sense for the RA to cut one of my terms short, because they did at one point lengthen my term to 6 months when the AG election was moved to the general elections a while back. But I'm generally in favor of removing the position, but as the bill stands now, I wouldn't support it. I'm still waiting for the second draft to come out from COE to see if I'd support it or not.
If we got rid of it, what would we do instead for whatever the AG used to be doing?
Right now, COE, the basis of the bill is that the prosecutor would be appointed whenever the prosecutor is needed, and it would be at base appointed by the delegate. But if the delegate has some sort of conflict of interest for some reason, either because they're the ones being tried or whatever, then it would fall to the vice delegate and so on down the line of succession. And right now, my main issues with that is that it's not quite independent enough. Just because, right now, there's no provision saying, oh, the delegate can't remove the prosecutor whenever they want, because right now the bill is just, this is just a normal appointed position like a minister. And the thing about ministers is that they can be appointed or dismissed at will. You know, it's hard, and there have been some thoughts about just scrapping the court system as we have it and replacing it with a more inquisitorial system, where we'd have a panel of justices and they'd just get the facts themselves and rule based on that. There wouldn't be any prosecution or defense. The court would just gather all the facts and rule based on that. But that's not the goal of the bill as it stands right now. But it would be interesting to see that a proposal based on that, and to see the debate on whether we'd go with the appointed prosecutor system, or if we'd replace that system entirely with something else.
What do you guys think is the better way to do it?
Personally, I think of the two, I would prefer the current system over a inquisitory court system. It seems good in practice, but I'm not so sure with how that would work in actuality.
Do you mean it's good in theory? Because if it's good in practice, I was going to ask you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I meant good in
places that are doing it.
I'm sorry. Thank you for catching that. Yes, it's good in theory, not in practice. My bad.
If the idea does come up for actual debate, presumably Lazarus has done the inquisitorial system before. I'm not sure if they still have it after Imke took power, but at least way back when, there was an inquisitorial system. And it'd be interesting to look back at that and see if that turned out well or not. But even then, we have to debate on whether it would work well with TNP specifically, because we can't just import stuff and expect it to work precisely.
Well, I know this still feels a little gimmicky, and I apologize for that, Wally, but How does TEP handle this?
How do we handle our law enforcement?
How do you? Yeah, what's your judicial system like? Do you use one of these two models or something else? Like, what's the deal?
I believe so. We have arbiters, and I believe that they are appointed by the delegate, or executive staff in some capacity. We are I think we're currently either thinking about adding an arbiter or replacing one. I think someone has resigned fairly recently, but, so they're appointed and they sort of just, enforce our charter and make sure that all those laws are followed. And then, anything else like, standard rules and stuff get handled by moderators.
Well, yeah, well, we have a pretty good moderation team, too, that handles the kind of non-legal and character stuff. So I think that's pretty common. Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
If you had more thoughts on that, go ahead, please.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Pretty much other than you guys electing them and us appointing them, it seems pretty much the same.
Okay. So in addition to the elections, obviously now we actually have a delegate in office, and he's made some appointments. Your thoughts on the cabinet, the cabinet choices that Fiji has made. I'll give you a pass on talking about comms because that's me, obviously, and this is part of the new comms effort to do more stuff with the NBS. So, yeah, I'm awesome. I know you don't have to say it. Go ahead, talk about the other ones.
So Bob, go ahead.
How could you, Bootsy? Recall! I think I am the best Minister of Defense appointment that the region has ever seen. Change my mind.
Excuse me?
You heard me.
You're just coasting on what I did, okay? For you.
So, I think they're done. So I had a very in-depth conversation with LFG Grande over on Bootsy Radio. If you guys haven't listened to that, it's definitely a great listen. But one of the things we talked about were the ministries, and he gave me a little bit of an in-depth look on, his thoughts on the ministries. But overall, I think, and I said this on my show, that he set up a very good foundation for what I think that is going to be a great term, because he set up a great foundation. I mean, I'll keep talking.
People alive, apparently.
Who has more perspectives on this? Wally, you have a perspective on this?
On the defense ministry?
Any ministry.
Well,
I think better question is, does he even know who the people are?
Aww. To be honest, I don't know who most of them are, but I do know about Chronostav, and it looks like LFG has appointed him WA minister for TNP, and I'm not extremely impressed, to be honest, but he's not the best option, but he is certainly better than most people that he could choose. He's written a resolution. It's a pretty good resolution on astronomical data, and so he has some experience. I just think that if you want the sort of ambitious stuff that LFG is running on for the WA, then, you might want someone with a little bit more experience with that.
Not just experience, like running the boring aspects of the ministry day-to-day stuff, which he has been doing for like a year and a half or something.
Yeah.
Very interesting take. I find it particularly amusing myself.
Yeah, in terms of the communications ministry, at first I was a little bit surprised that Ghost was picked as the Minister of Communications, just because I wasn't aware just how much, Ghost has an experience in terms of communications. So at first it felt like, an olive branch by Fiji to Ghost to be like, hey, you kind of helped me. Here's a ministry, is how it felt to me. Personally, when I first saw the appointment, but after talking, like I said, with Fiji, I got a little bit more of the why Ghost thing. And that's not a hit to Ghost. That's just my personal take on everything.
Ghost has made quite a name for himself in TNP just from World Assembly Affairs, because he basically joined TNP and Plenby was like, okay, you're Minister of World Affairs now. he made a bit of a name for himself in TNP with that. And then after he was delegate, it seemed his main focus became more on foreign affairs and how TNP should act in the global sphere. And he had a lot of thoughts about that and even wrote an essay about that in some event a while back. I don't remember which one specifically. But he seemed to be kind of more of a WA, a World Assembly Affairs and Foreign Affairs specialty. So I wasn't expecting to see him be appointed as the Minister of Communications.
Yeah.
Well, personally, I didn't feel surprised by any of the appointments by LPGA Grande. I kind of felt like, oh yeah, that's pretty much what I expected. The only exception was Ghost, and that's only to some extent. He was the, he is flexible, and you're flexible since you're here. Yeah.
Yeah, their Fiji's cabinet isn't exactly out there and exciting. It's mainly just Fiji himself. That's kind of exciting to see what he'll do with the delegacy. Most of his appointments have been rather old hands in each ministry, like McMacedonia as Foreign Affairs, Tilams as World Assembly Minister, Marcus Antonius, an up-and-coming deputy minister, become a full-on minister in Home Affairs. And so Ghost is mainly the big news when it comes to appointments, really.
Sure. I really do like the appointments of specifically Ghost and Marcus Antonius. Marcus Antonius, he was doing some really good work as a regular staffer, both in comms and home affairs, and then got the deputy minister. He got the ball rolling really well with the deputy minister position in both of those ministries. And then I listened to the Bootsy Radio, and from what I gathered, he considered me another new face, Pielt and Marcus, as well as BMW Surfer and Syrixia, all for Minister of Communications. But I was going to be Minister of Defense. We talked about this in advance. Marcus Antonius was going to be Minister of Home Affairs. BMW was retiring. Sear was going to be focused more on culture, and that basically left Ghost with Pielt and whoever else to pick up as comms minister. And so he picked Ghost because of the incredible work that he did with the WA symposium, specifically in the NBS broadcast, in which he recorded and organized all the different information and all the different voices that came in and left over the span of that several hour broadcast, which went really, really well. I've yet to listen to the entire thing, but it basically came down to that in terms of comms, from what I gathered.
Man, it's like you've listened to the entire interview with Fiji on Bootsy Radio. I think you were quoting it word from word at some points, Bob.
I did.
Someone's breathing.
This just in, the NBS plagiarizes from private media.
We're not private anymore. We are trying to promote more of that stuff, so I appreciate the cross-promotion. I think Bootsy wants to get a deputy position.
Yes, I talked. Sorry, this is going to be the fourth plug. Yes, during that interview, we talked about, you know, incorporating NBS with, you know, not having just one, you know, NBS broadcast, kind of like how EBC works. But I feel like NBS works because we have so many voices at the table. And I'm sure that we can bring some other people on to do some different, you know, talk shows or Q&As, or like I mentioned, Wondrous's, you know, if you wanted to do something with, you know, ethics or something cool like that.
Ethics are very cool.
I do want to make one correction to something that I said earlier. It turns out I have a bad memory. Tlams actually has a substantially lot more involved history with the GA than I remembered. Sorry about that, buddy.
I apologize. Don't kick me from the VC again.
Sounds like he got to you.
Yeah, he knows my address.
Yeah, the WA community is very tiny, and everybody knows each other.
So I think that conversation is exhausted. What next?
Yeah, so I guess we should probably go to the thing that everybody was really eager to sink their teeth into, but kind of afraid to go into. So we had an interesting delegate race, or at least we could have had an interesting delegate race, and then something more interesting than the election happened. So anybody want to talk about that?
It was technically still interesting.
So I...
Power of Rum.
Sorry, go ahead.
Go on. No, go ahead. You do go ahead.
So I obviously can't comment too much on this because I am the moderating justice of that case. So I'm just going to leave it to you guys to answer your decision, Magic. We should have it in the next... I hate to use these words together because people are going to kill me when I use them, but should be the next few days because it is the Memorial Day holiday. Asta has run into some stuff, so she can't look over the final review, but I've typed everything up and it is ready to go as soon as Silly String looks over it. If for those of you who are watching the or listening to the recorded version, they are saying that it's July, so that's why I'm kind of chuckling to myself. It shouldn't take July, okay?
Next few days was 55 days.
It's been years. Oh, Jesus. Well, then, yeah, Mad Jack and his, I believe he's here, and his drunken Roma escapade.
Mad Jack, you're an idiot.
No, he was drunk. He's very drunk, so... But I don't know.
Don't
excuse
us and drunk kids.
Yeah,
drunk
shit. Guessing drunk and doing crime.
Don't NS and drunk.
Unless you're Evil Wolf, in which case you might get away with it. But yeah. What do you say about that? What can you say about that?
Well, what can we say, Malf? Your name in Discord right now is Treble Mouse. So
clearly, yes, I mean,
it has left an impact on the greater game.
Your offer Treble is never refused. Yeah, I mean...
Mine is currently very much Treble, so...
Many Trebles, all the Trebles.
Also, you're a rat, not a mouse. Make up your damn mind.
At this point, I don't know anymore. Okay, no, we're not getting into a mouth discussion. It's a magic discussion.
Guinea pigs for the win.
Fuck your guinea pigs. Rats are better. But as I was saying, I mean, what's he meant to discuss about that? Yeah, he got pissed drunk, like, to a ridiculous extent, and did some dumb shit. Well, what do you expect? Do you expect him to think right when he's drunk as hell? No.
Okay, but what did he do?
What did he do? Well, the people who may not know were either presumably watching this from a recording. He drank over half a bottle of, I believe it was 40% alcohol content rum, I believe. Whichever way, very high alcohol content. Got incredibly drunk, all the point which he, according to the people in VC, which he was in at the time, you could barely understand him. Then proceeded to offer to members of the MPO Senate, Elgarth and Zoriat, favourable treaties, or treaties in drunken speak,
many
and also military support and voters, and yeah, and proceeded to, they reported it to TNP, and now we have the court case because he got drunk.
That's fun.
Very fun, yeah.
Yeah. I do want to thank the MPO for letting us know about that. That was very, very
yeah.
Cool. Thanks, guys.
I mean, it's good to see that they actually are willing to put what they're saying into practice by actually supporting sovereignty like this. I mean, they did a similar thing with the Perconium with that Kendi guy, like in 2016 or something.
Well, it's, like, why would they accept help from someone who's incredibly drunk? Like, there's no reason to, like, keep that hidden.
Well, yeah, that's true, actually. I mean, they'd be stupid to accept it.
Well, yeah, I guess blackmail, I guess, if Mad Jack won, but, like, yeah, that's actually a good point, EW, about blackmail. But I don't know. I guess it was probably worth it more, considering their new foreign affairs direction to bring it to our attention.
Because and they've in fairness,
or when it comes to people trying to coup TNP and shit like that.
I mean, in fairness, if this had happened, say, a batter of months ago when Perg was still running the show, I would not think it would be guaranteed that they would have told us. So, yeah, I think it's worth congratulating them on that. It's worth noting.
Well, I think if that were the case, Magic would have been reasonable enough. I don't think he would have hid.
Oh,
at least,
not.
I hope he wouldn't have hid from us. that, I doubt that. Oops, yeah. I was drunk, and hey, I did this wrong thing. So I think Magic has enough of a conscience to tell
yeah,
me.
I mean,
so.
Yeah, obviously. I think so.
Yeah, he did actually speak to Fiji in private message afterwards, kind of talking a bit about it, but he didn't at the time know all of what he did because he was basically nearly blackout drunk. So he kind of left out some important details when he spoke to Fiji, which was a bit of a problem.
Yeah.
But he did at least reach out to Fiji about it.
Yeah, it was an effort. There has been some discussion following this about intent in Team Fiji's justice system, Team Fiji's law. It's nasty. It's a bad situation.
But, you know, a lot of people said a lot of the stuff you guys did. Oh, he was drunk, very, very drunk, didn't know what he was doing, etc. You know, he's not really a traitor. I want to say, you know, Magic's a really cool guy. I don't think he's a traitor either. I don't think he would ever undermine our government, you know, to get ahead. I think he was, I don't know, he was probably in some kind of mood getting drunk like that. He probably was a little frustrated by the election and definitely concerned about Fiji's position on, you know, Defender stuff. As that came up, we didn't talk about that, but that was a very interesting angle. And yeah, the next day he realized he made a mistake, but ultimately, I think we can all agree that something had to be done. You know, mistakes are made. Mistakes have consequences. Doesn't mean he's permanently blacklisted and, you know, dead to us or anything. But I know a lot of other regions probably think it's a little bit much that we're, you know, taking him to court and all of that.
Yeah.
That is our way. And, you know, that's the flip side of democracy, I think. And I don't think it's a bad thing to, you know, own up your mistakes and take the consequences.
Hmm. I don't think that given the kind of culture, I'll let you speak in a second. I think given the culture and the justice system that we have here, I don't think we could have really just pushed it aside and ignored it. Maybe if we were more like Cyrus or TWP, it would be fine, but I don't think that it would have been reasonable for us to just say, oh, he's drunk, it shouldn't bother, just go ahead, no problem.
I think accountability is the other half of responsibility.
Hmm.
And so he should be held accountable for what he did. Even if he was drunk at the time, it was still a pretty terrible mistake. And if the NPO took advantage of that mistake, it would have been very bad.
Yeah. And we should be very careful about just kind of brushing things aside because they were drunk or whatnot, because there's no way we ought to prove that over the internet. So you do run the risk of people just saying, oh, I was drunk or I was high when that happened, to try to excuse themselves.
I'm also surprised on how quick the court case actually went.
True.
I mean, I was actually, you know, expecting that, you know, COE, especially going into it, COE and Magic had very, very different interpretations of, you know, what needed to be done about that, and even looking over both of their recommendations, they couldn't be any different. So I'm surprised it was like, okay, we're going to drop everything else. You know, here's what we're going to charge you for. So I was actually surprised about that. I thought it would go on forever.
Well, I was surprised about that too.
Yeah, I actually got home from work and Asta was like, okay, the court case is done now. We're ready for the sentencing phase. I'm like, what? I just. And we just started.
Yeah, like, Mad Jack has been very apologetic for what he's done. He knows what he's done. And, like, COE, he will, like, bring the book against you, but, you know, the book is reasonable, and he will... I mean, I assume that the two spoke in private about the plea deal, given that it happened. But they even though they have very opposite interpretations of how sentencing should go down, which I like the two opposing interpretations that the court then can then consider and come to a reasonable middle ground. That was the quickest possible court case, really.
I'll give Magic credit for that, in large part because of how apologetic and cooperative he's been the whole time. He hasn't been, you know, digging his heels in the sand and refusing to cooperate and saying, I'm innocent, this is ridiculous, you know, making the whole thing out of it. He's been a huge part of why the case has gone as quickly as it has.
I think the case probably wouldn't have gone down so quickly if the AG wasn't willing to talk to Mad Jack about how about the plea deal or anything like that. Like, if there wasn't any plea deal offered, most likely, Matt, if I were to guess, Mad Jack would have pleaded innocent to some of the more serious charges, at least, just because of how serious some of the charges were.
So what's going to happen then at the end of this, do we think?
Oh, well, I can't answer that.
Yeah, don't get yourself in trouble. The other people who aren't on the court, what do you guys think is going to happen as a result of this? Like, what's the end result going
to
be?
I mean, I think obviously he's going to have his voting rights and probably rights to run for election restricted in some way. I think it's just mainly a matter of how long that will be and how far that voting rights extends. Like, is it just a ban on voting on elections, or would it be a ban on voting for anything in the regional assembly or anything like that? Like, it's mainly just a question of how far reaching and how long lasting those bans are, really.
But we all think he's going to be back eventually, right? He's going to run for office again. He's going to be just fine.
Oh, yeah, definitely. He's actually going to stay. That's a given.
I think something that's blatantly obvious in this case was, even though there was the capability for a lot of harm to be done, MJ never intended to do that harm. So the court needs to consider that when it comes to their decision and the punishment weighed down.
Okay, well, I think we're all...
Yeah. I think it is a very fair interpretation of what was presented to us during that sentencing phase. So I think a good middle ground, like you said, was achieved, I think.
We'll see in the next quote-unquote few days.
Okay, listen.
The next few days, guys. It'll happen in a few days, I swear. Fucking hell. Any more comments? Or
nope, I think that's it.
Staring into each other's eyes thoughtfully.
That sounds very inappropriate. Okay.
Well, I mean, we did kind of exhaust all of the planned topics, so, yeah.
Now for unplanned topics. Dear Yolkon.
Is it Yolkon or Yolkon? I've always said Yolkon. I think so. No? Maybe not?
No.
He was in here earlier, I know that. Okay, I don't think so.
He's offline right now.
So, does anybody have any other topics we want to discuss that were not planned?
Why moderation has not banned Malph yet? He's a clear regional threat.
That's more of an admin thing to ban. Sure. Oh, you mean from like the Discord or like from TMP entirely?
Is this a serious discussion now?
I think they mean from NS.
Get a moderator to do it.
Oh, wait. Like NS moderation? Whatever.
You've definitely entered the shitposting phase of the broadcast.
So, Wally, since I have you here.
yeah, he's still here.
I feel bad for him because, you know, this was mostly TMP-centric, and I did invite him because we wanted to talk about, you know, kind of a comparison to other regions. And obviously I did ask him some questions about TEP, but really wasn't a lot of opportunities for him to jump in. I don't know, you've been hanging around TMP recently, Wally. What's kind of your impressions of how things have been going on here from what you could see? Even if you don't really know all the people yet. Just like, what are your thoughts on your experience?
Yeah, well, actually, I did enjoy sitting back, you know, for most of this and, you know, just getting a better idea of, you know, as to how the region interacts with itself and, you know, what people think of their leadership and, you know, how their elections have been going. So that's been good, actually. Sticking around in your Discord and, you know, checking out how your citizens, you know, interact with each other day to day, I'm actually pretty impressed, especially, you know, with the degree of participation that your citizens have in, you know, the Discord and in the RMB and all of that. I'm quite impressed, you know, the amount of people that you can get to regularly post and just talk to each other.
Yeah, I'm actually surprised how many... Sorry, I know I'm not Wally. But I'm actually surprised how many people we have tuning in live to MBS. I can't see the actual count because I'm on my phone and it won't let me do push to talk and look at the numbers at the same time. But we've got a lot of people here. Now, we did ping everybody. Everyone. But other than pinging everybody, I mean, we've got a lot of people here, including 10 listeners. Wow, it looks like a lot more. I'm surprised that a lot of people, including like GBM, is here and listening. It's just really cool to see that we've got so many people here.
It's been a while since our last broadcast, and we have a new minister leading this broadcast, so that's always interesting.
Yeah, Ghost has been doing an all right job.
What happened to this broadcast?
You joined.
Fan mouth.
I joined at the start. It couldn't have deteriorated after I joined.
You've not been in any recent other NBS broadcasts, so that's why there's the decline quality.
I can't argue with that. Fair play.
Okay. Well, we kind of started touching on a topic which I thought would be kind of interesting to end on. You know, Wally's here from TEP, and TEP, of course, is the other region, the other GCR that has a huge amount of WA votes, and he obviously had a lot to say about our WA minister, so I was just kind of curious, and I'll open this to the whole panel, including Wally. What do you think is going to happen to the endorsements to the WA programs of our ministries in the term ahead? And, you know, for us, it's the next 4 months. I know TEP's cycle's a little different. How do you think that's going to change and develop, and where will we be in 4 months? Is TEP going to continue to maintain their comparative advantage over the other GCRs but still be number two, or are they going to increase it? Are we going to, you know, keep going forward? What do you think?
I imagine it's definitely going to depend on how, you know, actively involved the WA minister and the delegate are in increasing World Assembly membership and just activating all of their residents to get more involved in the WA in general. But I imagine, you know, unless something crazy happens, it will stick around in the number one spot for quite some time.
Yeah, personally, I don't really see TMP being overtaken anytime soon.
You know, for instance, last few months we've had our whole marsupial mega event going on, and in the East Pacific, that's definitely increased World Assembly participation, or at least the ratio of members to non-members, as we've been sort of purging a bunch of puppets.
That doesn't get you more endorsements, though.
Yeah, but it makes it look more active.
Yeah, but your number still is whatever your number is when you cast a vote, so I don't think that really helps you guys.
True. I think the endorsement has risen a little bit, but we're still working on it. I don't think we're going to catch up to TNP anytime soon, though.
Yeah.
Well, TMP has WADEP, so it's going to be very hard for anybody to catch up to TMP.
Yeah, we're kind of an inherent advantage here.
Anybody can have that if they just put the work in.
Yeah, and have Ren.
Oh yeah, Ren's amazing.
Yeah, I don't know how you're looking.
Let's raid Winterfell and...
Oh, fuck, don't get Winterfell again. You're going to evoke the fucking demons. Jesus.
We're gonna raid Winterfell again, to 1,200 WA.
Look, I don't want to mention Winterfell. I like to think it never happened, personally. Let's not have you on the topic.
Yeah, that's not a Winterfell topic that's gonna come up ever again.
I hope not. Oh, Jesus Christ. Okay, no Winterfell. I'm not discussing it. Ends now.
Okay, well, I don't want to beat a dead horse. So I guess we'll close up shop here, and that was certainly a NBS broadcast. Don't know if it was a good one or anything like that, but...
It's a start.
Yeah, just, you know, programming note, we are going to try to do these more often, so if this one sucks, maybe the other ones won't suck as much, and, you know, we won't have only, like, 3 to 0.2 and then say, wow, that was a really bad term, so hopefully... Some of you guys will come back again, and you guys will keep listening, and we'll keep doing these and get better at them. And so happy Memorial Day weekend, everyone, and we'll see you around.